Sam.
No hymns, please.
She's going to see now. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
May the Father of mercies, the Father of all consolation, be with you.
And with your spirit.
In the waters of baptism, our brother Dave died with Christ and rose with him to new life. May you now share with him eternal glory. As we gather this morning to do three very important things. We have come here in the first place to give thanks for the life of Dave Hughes, for a life well lived, a life thoroughly lived, a life with gentleness and kindness, some spectacular mistakes, I'm sure, a life with flaws and celebration, a human life, a fully human life, but a life inspired by the divine, a life that embraced the presence of the divine throughout. So we come to say thank you that we knew Dave. Thank you that he touched our lives. Thank you that he made a difference in our world. Thank you that we could learn from him. We have also come to pray for his soul. He has gone on a journey that we have not yet experienced, a journey that we too will someday follow. And so we pray, as we do for everyone that we care about when they go somewhere that we do not know, for a safe journey, a journey home, a journey to the house of the Father, a journey to the banquet of the Lord. We've also come to pray for ourselves as we continue our life's journey, as we stumble and sometimes lose the way, as we face all the challenges of this world and this life. We pray that we may hold on to what is good, that we may remember what we learned from Dave, that we may follow the light. I invite you in a moment of silence to allow the gratitude for this man, for his friendship, for his kindness, for the good things that he did in this life, to well up in our hearts. And I invite you now to be seated as we listen to the tribute by his great friend, Benny Howard. Benny, if you'll come up.
Good morning, friends, and a special word of greetings to Dave's daughter, Sue Henderson, Dave's granddaughter, thanks so much. Good morning, friends, and a special word of greetings to Dave's daughter, Sue Henderson, Dave's granddaughter, Kirsty Stern, and her husband, Dane. And to Dave's stepson, Jesse Ruiz, and his wife, Gudrun, and their children. And then to all the friends gathered here and connected around the globe through streaming. Yes, we indeed praise the Lord for the life of Dave Hughes. It is a privilege and an honor to share with you a tribute today of Dave Hughes, one of the great legends of wines and spirits of South Africa and the world. And above all, a dear friend of thousands of people here and around our world. He was an icon, an ambassador, a teacher, a winemaker, a distiller, a journalist, a writer, a wine judge, a spirit judge, not only in South Africa for many years, but also around the world, and above all, a very humble and a very kind man. Rhodesian born, he was a keen sportsman in his young days and represented Rhodesia in rugby, water polo, hockey and basketball. His interest in sport spanned many generations, but he loved it to participate in sport, and that led to him becoming a keen runner. Are we losing the signal? But he loved to participate in sport that led him to become a keen runner with his permanent green number for completing 10 Comrades ultra marathons as a symbol of his determination, while he also completed the Two Oceans and a host of other marathon running events in his lifetime. Our good friend, the late Dampy Bailey, often introduced Dave at wine events as the oldest wine personality in South Africa, as he was Jan van Riebeeck's first winemaker in 1659. And it often feels like Dave has always been here for generations, as his knowledge of the South African wine industry was just so amazing and so immense. Here, I believe, lies Dave's greatest contribution to our industry. He had this wealth of knowledge and had a longing to communicate it and his love of wine every day of his life. That's why he said, "Wine is the best thing to have. Conserve water, drink wine." But in meetings, tastings, presentations, articles, or books, there Dave was. Our wine industry is so much richer with the legacy of Dave. If there is one word that will always remind me of Dave, then it is sharing. Here lies the greatness of a man that was always ready to give, to share whatever was required from him. His vast knowledge of the liquor industry per se, his passion for wine food, and his unlimited knowledge of the history of wine in South Africa. Dave was responsible for me joining the wine industry when he appointed me at SFW 44 years ago. It feels like yesterday. And one of the first lessons he taught me was to share a good bottle of wine with others. Many a time when we were at lunch together with a special wine at the table, he would get up and take a glass to another table where somebody he knows was sitting, sharing the excitement of the wine. Dave spent more than 30 years at Stellenbosch Farmers Winery, together with the finest group of wine men that served our industry at that time. He had a huge influence on the road that the company took in those days. He steered the Niederberg auction for many years, since its inception in 1975, to become what is regarded as one of the most prestigious wine auctions ever in the world. And one of his biggest contributions came when SFW launched the wine plan in 1979 to put new energy into marketing and selling wine in our country. He was instrumental in selecting 120 young, enthusiastic people to execute this plan that included the establishment of the Cape Wine Academy. Dave was now in his element, as his love and passion for wine was now embedded in this wine education organization, and he was ready to pass on his vast knowledge. Together with Phyllis Hands, Dave built up the Cape Wine Academy that has benefited thousands, I want to say hundreds of thousands of people in South Africa, learning about wine and making it part of their lifestyle. This also led to the Cape Wine Master qualification that was instituted by Dave and Phyllis, with the first three Cape Wine Masters qualifying 40 years ago. In recognition for his dedication and contribution to wine education, Dave was made an honorary Cape Wine Master. Dave has a long list of local and international honors bestowed upon him in his long and distinguished career. A highlight was the 1659 Medal of Honor that he received in 2013 at Groot Constantia for his lifelong dedication to the industry. But all these honors spanned across not only wine, but to brandy, to whiskey, and to gin. Few people know that he distilled Old Buck gin, today the biggest gin in South Africa, in his early days as a distiller. As the only leading South African wine and spirit judge at the International Wine and Spirit Competition in London since he helped it founding in 1974, Dave shared his vast tasting experience over more than 40 years in South Africa. He was instrumental in establishing the world-class judging systems at Veritas and the Top 10 Punitas judging. For many years, Dave said grace at many luncheons and dinners in our country. And those words from his grace echoed his strong belief as a devoted churchman and Catholic, and his humor. So please allow me just to read these few lines from his prayer at the Veritas dinner in 2014. Our thanks, Lord, for food, in a world where many walk in hunger for faith, in a world where many walk in fear for friends, in a world where many walk alone. We give you thanks for all this food and drink. Accept our thanks and make us think of all the good word, work in deed and deed, so necessary to provide our need. So necessary to provide our need indeed. Now let us all get at the well-filled plate to add those extra kilos to our weight. Sadly, Dave lost his wife and partner, Lorna, in a car accident late last year. They were happily married, surrounded by an ever-growing pack of amazing rescue dogs. For 21 years, they were together, and many of us had the chance to share many a good glass of wine with them at their house in Devon Valley. Dave was a humble man, with often that somewhat naughty smile, a twinkle in the eye, and with his lovely sense of humor. He never changed over the years. The Dave I met in 1978 was the same Dave I saw for the last time on Sunday evening last week. He touched many lives for many years and leaves behind a legacy that requires us now to continue with. The example he has set must be an inspiration for the new generation of wine people in our country. We owe it to him. We honor and salute you, Dave, our dear friend. And with the same greeting that was always at the bottom of your emails, or at the end of a conversation, or with a glass of wine, we say, cheers. I thank you.
We're very grateful for those words that stir so many good memories for each of us. I invite you now to please stand with me as we pray the opening prayer. Almighty God and Father, it's our certain faith that your Son who died on the cross was raised from the dead, the first fruits of all who have fallen asleep. Grant that through this mystery, your servant Dave, who has gone to his rest in Christ, may share in the joy of his resurrection. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated now as we listen to the readings from Holy Scripture.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. On this mountain, the Lord Almighty will prepare a feast of rich food for all peoples, a banquet of aged wine, the best of meats and the finest of wines. On this mountain, He will destroy the shroud that enfolds all people, the sheet that covers all nations. He will swallow up death forever. The Sovereign Lord will wipe away the tears from all faces. He will remove his people's disgrace. The Lord has spoken. The word of the Lord. We will sing Psalm 23, which is in your leaflets that you have, please.
Reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. No one lives for oneself, and no one dies for oneself. For if we live, we live for the Lord. And if we die, we die for the Lord. So then, whether we live or die, we are the Lord's. For this is why Christ died and came to life, that he might be Lord of both the dead and the living. Why then do you judge your brother? Or you, why do you look down on your brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bend before me, and every tongue shall give praise to God. So then each of us shall give an accounting of himself to God. The word of the Lord.
The way, the truth, and the life.
Alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you
and with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body." Then he took a cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now on until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Uit die Evangelie van Matteus, hoofstuk 26. En terwyl hulle eet, het Jesus brood geneem en die seën gevra. Daarna het hy dit gebreek en vir sy disippels gegee met die woorde: "Neem, eet, dis my liggaam." Toe neem hy hun beker en nadat hy die dankgebed uitgespreek het, gee hy dit vir hulle en sê: "Drink almal daaruit, want dis my bloed, die bloed waardeur die bond verbond verseël word en wat vir baie vergiet word tot vergewing van sondes. Ek sê vir julle, van nou af sal ek nie weer van hierdie wyn drink nie, tot op die dag wanneer ek saam met julle die nuwe wyn in die koninkryk van my Vader sal drink." Dis die woord van die Here.
Please be seated. A theologian once wrote that every believer, every faithful Christian, writes with their lives a fifth gospel. We have the four canonical gospels in the Bible: Mark, Matthew, John, and Luke. But each of us, through our lives of faith, of attempting to live the good news that Christ brings us, writes a gospel anew. And so we come today to remember and look at the good news according to Dave Hughes. he enjoyed writing down historical events and births and deaths and those kind of things. And even when he did the announcements here at the end of a Sunday Mass, he would treat us to some historical events on that day or from that week. And as you know, and as Benny Howard said, he had an encyclopedic knowledge of history, of wine history, and also of church history. Urgent phone call. Dave wrote a gospel with his actions, also with his mistakes. In his gospel, like in all of us, there are lines scratched out, pages torn out and burnt, pages never meant to be seen by anyone else, but also pages and pages of a life well lived, of love given and love received, of kindness, gentleness, and compassion. Those gifts from the Holy Spirit, which Dave lived par excellence. The first reading from the book of Isaiah, a book which is also often referred to as a fifth gospel because it tells us so much about the Messiah, gives us an image of heaven that is very different from the one that people often have of sitting on a cloud and playing a harp for all eternity, an image which I personally don't find. I'm not musically talented, and I think that it could get a bit much after a while. But Isaiah gives us a very different picture, a picture which also I know resonated deeply with Dave. It tells us that when we reach that mountain, the home of the Father, the one who made us, the one who sent us into this world to do our best and to return to him with the good things that we have done as our medals, there is waiting a feast unlike any that we have ever seen. An enormous table with people from every race and nation gathered at it. A table groaning with wonderful food and fine wine. A celebration where there is no space for tears, for pain. There is no more space for regret and guilt. No more space for evil or hurt. A place where there is only joy, where every tear is wiped away, where we understand finally all the mysteries and questions that we carry through this life. Dave understood deep in his being what Jesus speaks of in the gospel reading. He understood communion, sharing, breaking bread together, lifting a glass. He understood that divinity is present there when we share, when we rejoice, when we celebrate and give thanks. That spark of life, the twinkle in his eye, that did not leave him until the very end. For him, the sacraments were central to his life, and on Sunday afternoon, I had the honor of giving him the last sacraments, anointing him and giving him Holy Communion for one more time, sharing this bread of life, this cup of eternal joy. Dave carried deep in him that sense that we experience too at the table of the Lord, of sharing the good things of this life with others, to encourage them, to help them, to be there for them. He understood the fellowship of the table, the fellowship of the sacraments of the church. Pope Francis said in his address for the Day of Peace, the 1st of January every year, this year, he said, "No one is saved alone." And Dave understood that too, that perhaps out of some experiences of loneliness and aloneness in his own life, that people needed fellowship, friendship, encouragement, joy, sharing. The sacraments for us as Catholics are moments of encounter with the divine. And this lay at the center of who Dave was. He loved this church. He loved this community. I often used to tease him that the icon of St Nicolas behind me resembled him, and I always pointed out to people that it's not an image of Dave Hughes, but of the sainted bishop, St. Nicholas. So you can see it's a fair match. He loved this old wine cellar, built in the 18th century, to produce wine, to gladden the heart and lift people's spirits. One of my very favorite quotes, a quote which a priest once spoke out in a homily and which changed my life to a large extent, is the words of Saint Irenaeus, a very early church father, who said that the glory of God is a human being fully alive. We give thanks today also for the example of someone who lived his life to the full, who wore out his life like a pair of running shoes so that he could set it aside now and enter into a new reality, to drink the new wine in the kingdom. We know that he will keep us a seat there, that he will keep us a glass there, and we pray that one day we may be reunited with him. As we give thanks and we take our leave of our brother, we carry in our hearts much good things to remember. Perhaps some of us also learn things from his life that we feel we do not want to repeat in our lives. We learn from one another in so many different ways. We ask the Lord that his prayers may be with us, to continue to help us to live this sharing, this rejoicing, to live our lives to the full, and to do all the good we can. Amen. I invite you please to stand with me as we lift up our prayers for today and for those who love him and miss him. My dear friends, we believe that Jesus is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church. Confident that God hears the voices of those who trust in him, we lift up our prayers. In baptism, Dave, receive the light of Christ. Scatter the darkness now and lead him over the waters of death. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Our brother was nourished at the table of the Lord in this church. Welcome him now to the table of the heavenly banquet. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We think today, of course, of Lorna, of Dame P, and so many friends and family members of Dave, of ourselves who have gone before us and await us at that table in the kingdom. We pray that they may experience lasting peace and joy in heaven. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We also cannot help to think today of all those who have died through violence, who have not had a peaceful death surrounded by people who love them, as Dave did. Those who die through war and terrorism, those who have died in disasters like the earthquake in Turkey, and those who starve because they do not have the means to feed themselves or their children. We ask that the Lord will show mercy to those who suffer so unjustly these sins against his love, and gather them all into his eternal kingdom of peace. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
We lift up Dave's family and friends, all who are affected by his death, and all who learnt from his life. Grant them comfort and consolation. Heal our pain and dispel the darkness and doubt that may come from grief. Grant us peace and joy. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
And I invite you now to lift up in the silence of your heart the prayers, the blessings that you have carried here to this church today for our dear friend Dave, for those who love him. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
Lord God, give peace, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voices of your people whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in your kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Please be seated now. pray, my dear sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and the glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Dave, we beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Saviour may find in him a merciful judge who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your heart.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. In him the hope of blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts,
heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Please kneel or be seated now. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Save us, Saviour of the world, for by your cross and resurrection you have set us free. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world. Bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Stephen, the Bishop, the auxiliaries of Esther, with all the priests, the deacons, and all who minister to your people. Remember your servant David, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who was united with your Son in a death like his may also be one with him in the resurrection. Father, remember also all the brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Mother Mary and St. Joseph, with the Apostles, St. Nicholas, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honour is yours, for ever and ever.
Amen.
I invite you now to stand, please, and to join me, if you will, in praying the Our Father. This prayer reminds us that we are bound together in love as the children of a loving parent. The death of someone we love can cause us to feel cut off and alone, to feel cut off from the person who has died, from one another and from God. And so, if you wish to join hands, you're welcome to do so. We pray these words taught to us by our Savior and his divine teaching. Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign for ever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you
take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
May the body and blood of Christ keep us safe for eternal life. Over the body of Christ. The blood of Christ. Thank you. If you are not a Catholic, or if you are a Catholic who has not prepared yourself to receive Holy Communion, we still invite you to come forward for a blessing if you would wish that. Simply indicate that you want a blessing by crossing your arms over your body.
The body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ.
Amen.
The body of Christ. The body of Christ. The body of Christ.
Let us pray.
Lord God, whose Son left us in the sacrament of his body and blood food for our journey, mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our brother Dave may come to the eternal table of Christ, he who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Do please be seated now. On behalf of Dave's family and close friends, I would like to thank each and everyone who has made today's celebration possible, and all who have attended and brought their blessings and prayers here today. This is very greatly appreciated, and all the different ways in which people have made this celebration a special one in remembrance of our dear friend. We are now going to prepare to do the final commendation, the traditional Catholic farewell for one of our brothers and sisters. When we brought Dave's coffin into the church for his last visit here, his last Mass here, we sprinkled the coffin with holy water. That water blessed for this special task is sprinkled on the coffin to remind us of our tears, to remind us also of the water and blood that flowed from the side of Christ. And, of course, as a reminder of Dave's baptism, as a little child he was placed in this special relationship with Christ, and that relationship stood him in good stead through his life. And now we hand him back to the Father. We are also going to bless his coffin with incense, the fragrant smoke rising up, reminding us that we pray for him on his journey. We'd have loved to give him a glass of cognac or a bottle of wine for the journey, but we can't do so. And what does go with him on his final journey is our prayers and our love and remembrance, and that smoke rising up reminds us of that, to accompany him on his last journey home. Before we go our separate ways, we take leave of our brother. We pray that our farewell may express our affection for him, that it may ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. The response to the song of farewell is, "Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High."
Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High.
Saints of God, come to his aid. Angels of the Lord, hasten to meet him.
Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High.
Dave, may Christ, who called you, take you to himself. May he lead you to the heavenly Jerusalem.
Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High.
Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon him.
Receive his soul and present him to God the Most High.
Oh,
Would you please stand? Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Dave, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon him in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith, until we all meet in Christ, and are with you and our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
My sincere thanks to Deacon Trevor Peterson, Father David Rowles, for assisting at this Mass, for Mrs. Shireen Saldana and Michelle Saldana for the music, and Madalena De Cagna and Virginia Perez for preparations and help. You are invited to La Pineta after the service to raise a glass to Dave and to continue to celebrate his life. There will be another formal celebration of his life in April, and I also will be celebrating the Mass of St. Vincent of Saragossa for winemakers and distillers on the 16th of March here in this church, and that Mass of course will be offered specially in memory of Dave. Been thinking often about whether we should skip it this year, because Dave was in mourning, not expecting that we would be celebrating his Requiem Mass, but I think that in his honour we should continue and celebrate that. So it will be on the eve of St. Patrick's Day, in competition with the beer brewers the next day. So, I think St. Patrick also, the Irish are also consumers of distilled spirit, so I think it will be an appropriate date to celebrate the feast. We pray that this service was of consolation for those who needed consolation, that it brings peace to all who came here today to pay their respects and to bless our brother on his final journey. May the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, Vrienden, if you would like to move a little bit closer to this end and have a glass of wine with you, it will be much appreciated. The table on my right has got the Chateau Petrus and the Chateau Lafitte. So if you come closer, this is the table where you will get some of that, if you can get your way to the front of the room. Hi, Rico. Is dit nou tyd om al die meisies te groet? Ek het nog net al net nou gegroet. Well, friends, on such a splendid autumn day in 2023, we are together, and I can hear the vibe out there is one of happiness and one of some kind of enjoyment as we are gathered for a very special person at one of the most beautiful venues of our industry here at Lourensford. We are not going to make long speeches. Dave would not have liked us to have long speeches today. So if you have a long speech, we have a video camera here. You can come and deliver your long speech. It's going to run for 3 hours. So you've got lots of time to record your message. But we're going to have just a few words from a few friends and from a few people that were very close to Dave over the years. But I would like to start with something which I'm sure all of you have experienced in your life, phoning Dave on his phone at the office. You have reached the number of Dave Hughes. It is cloudy and cool with showers in Devon Valley today. The temperature is 23 degrees. On this day in the year 1043, Edward the Confessor was crowned as King of England. And in 1933, on 3 April, the first flight over Mount Everest took to the air. And on this day in 1973, a pilot cellular project was launched in New York City. And in 1974, 3 April, the gold price hit a record of $197 an ounce in Paris. It is also the birthday today of Doris Day, American singer and actress who was born in 1922, and American actor Marlon Brando. And it is a happy birthday today to wine legend Günter Brösel, who, by the way, turns 89 today. Cheers to Günter. That was the regular message. By the way, those are all real facts from Mrs. Google. So that was Dave's pleasure to give us a history lesson when you phoned him. And I know many people that phoned him just to check the weather and to check whose birthdays they might have missed, because he had a long list of wine people's birthdays, and then for some interesting historical facts. We have Jesse Roos, who's going to say a few words on behalf of the family. We have Sue Wardrop, who's been with us in the wine industry as long as I've been, and we will not reveal that period of time to you. She's much younger than me, by the way. And then we're going to ask Rico Besson to say something from his heart as one of the senior people in our industry, and then we're leaving the best for last. Tim Hutchinson, who's been around in the industry almost as long as I've been around and who has been a very close friend of Dave for many years. And then the mic is open thereafter if anybody would like to say something. I have a letter from Sue Henderson, Dave's daughter, if you allow me to read it. Dave married my mom, Kathy, when I was about 3 and adopted me soon after. Sadly, Dave and Kathy's 5 babies did not survive. I remember much of my childhood around fields of rugby players, swimming pools of water polo players, even dams of Oxford and Cambridge type rowers. Dad enjoyed them all. He was a font of general knowledge. I certainly didn't need Google when it was homework time. My projects were either based on dogs or the wine industry. Holidays became journeys of learning, stopping at unusual memorials or strange geographical sites. Dad's beard, his trademark, was grown in 1970 on a 3-week camping holiday to Southwest Africa. Not a white beard, but an auburn red beard, in contrast to his black hair. I wonder how many of you saw Dad in a tie. Nope, not if he could help. He did wear a tie to my wedding, though. It was my mom's, Kathy's, job to hand embroider a wine glass onto every one of his work shirts. He liked to be unique. When we lived in Natal in the early 1970s, we stood on the side of the M13 on Comrades Day and watched those men slogging their way down to Durban. Dad declared them immediately to be crazy. A few years later, guess who was the crazy one? I can't say seconding him was fun or easy, especially one particular year with a 3-year-old son and a 6-week-old baby daughter in the car for a whole day. When my husband died suddenly 5 years ago, Dad phoned me every single weekend to see how I was. How difficult that the roles reversed when he lost his beloved Lorna. Dave was a grandfather to my 3 children, Richard, Kirsty, and Scott. Great-grandfather to Emmy and Amber, as well as step-grandfather to Jesse and Gaddy's 4, Fionn, Connor, Torren, and Skye. Dad, may the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be at your feet, and may God keep you in the palm of his hand. Shalom, love, Sue. What a moving tribute to Dave. And I think we can all see Dave in those words. Thanks, Sue. And now, Jesse, if you would like to say a few words.
Thank you, Eddie. Everybody, okay, here we go. Just want to say thank you to everybody for the messages received, the people who were able to attend today, the others that were not, but I know we'll probably be raising a glass to Dave anyway, in celebration of a life well lived. Special thanks to Benny, I know Elsie, Sue, all the arrangements today, the venue, Lourensford, the Brandy Foundation at the back. And there are quite a few people behind the doors responsible for the food on the tables. Unfortunately, Dave would probably start, like with every function, with a prayer. Unfortunately, didn't get time to write one. Dave was always generous, courteous, kind, and polite to a fault. I never once heard him complain. He had a passion for learning and delving deeply into topics. He had an unquenchable thirst, not just for drink, but for knowledge on a vast array of subjects, matters that extended further than just booze. An avid collector of books, wine, rocks on the farm, he had a passion for geology. Cats, dogs, toy cars, coins, stamps, and an unmatched sock collection. Dear, I had to put that in there. Yeah. So he always wears wore different socks on his feet. Made it a lot easier, I think, when you did lose one in the wash. I had the great pleasure of growing up with a glass of wine at the dinner table every night, albeit a small one. The privilege to taste different wines Dave would be writing notes on at the time. Appreciation for wine and alcohol was taught at a young age in the Hughes household. Set on a wine farm, the combination of the best food from the kitchen prepared by my mom, great wines to match, Dave and my mother at the table made the perfect setting for a happy time. A wonderful upbringing, two very special people to me. I had the pleasure of meeting friends from all over the world, having the opportunity to share glasses of wine, being part of the conversation of the most intriguing subjects. In the early days, when I got to know Dave, he had an office on the opposite side of the valley. I would ride my bike across the valley to go and see him, perhaps have a cup of tea. At that time, I was a bit too young to drink. And probably to more so to actually make use of his DSTV. It was a luxury we didn't have at home. He never was too busy. And instead, I think he's always happy to see people. I think it's something that a lot of people knew about him. It was never the wrong time. You'd always be happy to talk to anybody. I remember running out of fuel going down the Devon Valley Road on my motorbike one day. The next thing I knew, Dave was behind me. He offered to make a phone call, to which I obliged. Opening his boot, he remarked, "Well, I think there's a phone in here somewhere." At the time, it felt a bit odd, because inside the boot was a large display of items. Wine glasses, picnic baskets, toilet paper, probably items for every or any occasion. Always, it's probably something, a trait that I'm from his old army days, in preparation of anything. My mother used to joke, "You never have one of everything, but three or more of everything," and it was evident in the pantry. Of course, Dave never traveled without a corkscrew in his pocket. Many will know Dave's wicked sense of humor and wit. Now, this is quite a recent story where we had a friend, a nurse, who came to visit and just sort of check up on Dave and check on the meds and things like that. And after asking where the medicine cabinet was in the house, with a twinkle in his eye, he pointed to the cupboard in the corner of the room. We all watched with bated breath as she opened the doors to discover it was actually the drinks cabinet. I can't help but think there's a common thread. Through all that's been said, everybody has said the same thing about Dave. It may be the end of an era, but the lessons learnt, the knowledge shared, passion and zest for life will continue for many years to come as we take the baton and continue to run. Thank you. Thank you, Benny.
Thanks, Jesse. Those of you who remember Dave from the days that he used to travel a lot, remember the leather bag, can't think of a better word, that briefcase. Really, briefcase? It was more than a briefcase. Handbag, whatever you used to call it. Handbag, that's right. And some of the funniest moments we've had together traveling all around the world and around South Africa was to get onto a plane, and you would be served in those days a little breakfast, more decent than what you get nowadays, or lunch or dinner, and Dave would open this bag and out comes a proper pepper mill and a proper salt grinder. So that would arrive on his tray in front of him, and then comes this small little piece of breakfast or lunch or dinner, and he would open it up and beautifully covered with salt and pepper, and says, "At least you can eat this food now." And we ended up many times at tables where he used to get to the table before me, and he would make sure that there's a pepper grinder and a salt grinder in front of him or in front of me, because we would need it at the same time at the table. So he didn't care about the rest of the people. So whenever I use a salt grinder or a pepper grinder, Dave is with us in my house. Sue, would you like to come to us and share your moments and your moments of the great times of a great man?
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. I think I know most of you here this afternoon, and it's really fabulous to see you all here paying toast to a very, very special man. A Rhodesian by birth, a distiller by trade, a winemaker out of necessity, and a lover of the female form by desire. That was Dave's own intro about himself and his wife. For many years, and Dave has been part of my life, my whole wine life. He actually was responsible for employing me, amongst the other people in this room, like Benny Howard and quite a few others I can't recall right now, as a wine advisor in East London with the start of the Stellenbosch Farmers Wine Plan. And that was an amazing project. We had the most amazing training that I don't think ever been seen before or since. 3 weeks at the Belleville Inn, Holiday Inn, driving in a bus every day into SFW to be given this amazing speed training on wine. That was the start. A few years after that, I was offered to come down to Stellenbosch to run the Nederburg auction. And I basically worked under Dave Hughes and his department. After a while, I think most of you are quite well aware of the fact that he and I became more than work colleagues. And he was the most amazing partner, and he taught me so much, not only about wine, but about life, people, humility. He never had a bad word to say about anybody. And he really taught me so much about the world. He always put other people first, sometimes to his own detriment. And he had an amazing general knowledge, as has been mentioned before, and I won't mention, as Jesse had, his amazing library, thousands of books, all booze related. And we also met, we traveled quite a lot. I met amazing wine people across the globe, where Dave was universally loved and respected. He definitely was not a wine snob. He had great delight in chilling Lieberstein and putting it into a decanter and serving it as an arrival drink to his guests as an aperitif. And I don't think many people even knew what it was. He was incredibly generous. For many years, for example, he would buy my sister's children the Guinness Book of Records, even after we were no longer together. We were both runners and had done some comrades together. So whenever we travelled, we would run. The one day we were in the Barossa Valley in Australia, and Dave, I think you all know, never seemed to feel the cold. He was always in shorts, t-shirt, and preferably barefoot. No, he said we must go for a run. I said, okay. Off we go, we've got these little South African shorts on, short sleeve t-shirts, and it was fucking cold. I swear it was like -2. I said, Davey, this is too cold. He said, no, it's fine. Anyway, even the locals driving around actually stopped to look at these two idiots running down the road and almost semi-frost on the side of the roads. He had his payback because I said, right, we've got to drink port all day now. I've got to defrost. Another time, also a running story, we were in Zimbabwe. And it was a time of sanctions. Davey got up there to see some wineries or whatever. And we discovered there was a road race. And South Africans weren't allowed to compete in any of these races. Anyway, Davey had contacts and said, we're going to run. I said, okay, great. He said, well, don't talk too much and don't say where you're from. And if they do ask, say you're from Australia. So anyway, we finished. Unfortunately, we finished the road race, we showered and went straight to the airport. The next day, we see in the Harare Times back page, two South African illegal runners caught running the race in Zimbabwe. Thank the Pope he lived straight away. I'm afraid he landed up in jail. And as things happen in time, things come to an end. We went our different paths, but fortunately, and I was always grateful, we remained very, very good friends and would often chat. At that stage, I'd moved to Durban, and he still loved the female form and had many girlfriends, lady friends, girlfriends, whatever you want to call them. But no one ever really seemed to be there, special, whatever. Then one day he phoned me and he said, "Sue, I think I've met the lady and I want you to meet her." So he came to Durban. I think they came for some other reason, probably to introduce her to Kathy as well. So poor Lorna had to go through the whole range of girlfriends or wives, whatever. "And can we come and stay?" I said, "Yes, sure." So Lorna and Dave arrived, said hi, whatever. Dave said, "Cheers, I'm going off to Mass. See you later." And he left Lorna and I to like, well, okay. And it was great. Lorna and I just clicked straight away. We became extremely good friends. And we did a lot of amazing stuff together. The three of us went to the Karoo for a week. Whenever I came to the Cape on business, I would try and stay with them at least a night or two until the dogs got to 21 and I decided, no, it's a bit too crowded around here. But yeah, so many good times. I mean, we had parties, the Ratcliffs, the Easterbrooks, the Mossops, the Finlaysons, the Dalacheers. We had amazing times in those great Stellenbosch days. So yeah, it's been very hard to say goodbye. They both left a very big hole in my heart, especially Father Christmas, as he was often called. I can't imagine wine without Dave. It's just the two associated to me. But I'm very grateful and privileged to have spent the time with him. And I feel so blessed to have known this special, special human, perfect gentleman, kindness personified, has been a common thread through all our talks for 43 years. Sorry, Benny, I've given it away. And I'm so blessed that on the Monday, well, Jesse phoned me on the Sunday to tell me that Davey wasn't well. And Monday I just said to myself, I have to go through. And I went through to the hospital to see him, and he died that day later. So I was very grateful that I had that chance, thank you, Jesse, to say goodbye to a man that I've loved and admired all my life. My dear Dave, my world is not the same without you in it. And can we say cheers to a wonderful man?
Thanks, Sue, for revealing the age. It's fine. Rico?
We'll get over it.
We're over it already. Rico, dankie dat jy ingestem het om 'n paar woorde te sê. Ek weet jy het 'n groot hart vir die bedryf.
Benny, thank you, and thanks to the family. Benny phoned me and I said, "Benny, I can't say anything, or not too much about Dave, because I don't think I know him really like all of you do." So I said, "Well, at least let's give me my reflection on Dave." So thanks to LCB, the first time I met Dave is I was seated at the Veritas table, gala function, with Dame P next to me. And I remember three things from that evening in 2012. The first one is, I thought, what an amazing poet coming onto the stage and delivering the evening prayer. In English and Afrikaans, which I thought is fantastic. Then Dame P leant over and said, "Listen, Rico, you know that when Jan van Riebeeck arrived in 1652, Dave was here to greet him, hey?" Which took a bit away about the poets. And then afterwards, he was also seated at the table. I walked over and I thought, he was what an absolute humble individual, so positive, soft-spoken, and full of knowledge. So over the past 10 years, I've often saw Dave at wine functions, and I was always so impressed by his knowledge about wine, spirits, Kasi journalism, consultancy, and he loved sports. I mean, he knew everything from running to basketball to rugby. Little did I know, and I must say that's where, when I ultimately read his whole curriculum, where I felt so stupid, I must say, when I realized he's written 14 books. He's been on so many international tasting panels, and he's had an amazing leadership role. So lesson in that, talk to people, even if they're slightly gray. I remember, Christelle, one of the conversations where I thought I'll make some talk to him, and I asked him, so how does SA brandy compare to cognac? And I thought it's a great opener kind of question, and his answer is, I don't think we should continue along this route of holding cognac up as the holy grail of brandy. Good cognac is good, but there's oh so much that is not good. We should not compare South African brandy to cognac. It is a different style and type. It is, after all, made in a different climate. It's like trying to compare our wines with Burgundy and Bordeaux grape wines, but very different animals. To me, he said about brandy, to me, South African brandy is truly a product of our time. Like our new democracy, it really should be our celebratory drink, as it is distillable that actually came of age more or less as democracy arrived, which I thought is profound and takes us out of the French debate somehow. So this morning I had a look at, I really think that Dave was a pioneer. And there are so many definitions, but the one that stuck with me, a pioneer is someone who sees potential and who is an innovator who is willing to try new things, which I think if you read Dave's career is true about him. A pioneer pushes new boundaries, advances a course or an idea, or break a record. These men and women have experienced success in their field, sometimes overcoming great challenges. And then I thought, Dave was bold. He distilled, I don't know, pretty much everything that you can think about and experimented. Dave had vision. He was one of the founding members of the Nierberg Auction and the Cape Wine Academy. Dave had dedication and persistence. He had a green number to run the Comrades, amongst other things. And about creativity and passion, there's not a lot more to say. I think amazing leader. So in the words of Steve Jobs, rightly or wrongly, my summation from Dave Louis Hughes is that Steve Jobs said, the people who are crazy enough to think that they can change the world are the ones that do. And somehow, looking back at the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and looking at the life and the career of a Dave Lou Hughes, they fundamentally changed the direction of the industry. And so to me, Dave Hughes has left a tangible mark on the industry, the fraternity, and is a true legend and a pioneer.
Hi, Donkey. He said 4.5 minutes. It was 4 minutes and 50 seconds. Well done, Riku. Friends, Tim Hutchinson is one of the finest wine and spirit leaders in our country. And I couldn't think of asking somebody who has known most probably as long as me or as long as some of you in the room to speak from the heart about a man that I had a great admiration for, like I have a great admiration for what Tim has done for our industry. And Tim, thank you that you agreed to be here today and to say a few words. Thank you very much. As you know, Tim is the head boss of Douglas Green Billingham. He doesn't want me to say that, but he is still chairman for I don't know how many more years, 40, 50 more years or so.
Thank you. Firstly, I'm honored to have been asked to talk on behalf of the industry, an industry we all love dearly. Dave must be looking down on this function and being very proud of the legacy he's left and the fine tributes he had today. He was a very special guy. I remember a couple of years back, I had the honor of speaking at Douglas Green Jr.'s funeral in Peniel. And here came two gentlemen, Dampy Bailey pushing Dave in his wheelchair, and we arranged for them to come on the side of the church. And there were a lot of youngsters there, and I said to the youngsters, look, any of you, you're burying your grandfather here. Have any of your friends at school had their grandfather's death mentioned in the report, the Burger, the Sunday Times? No, they hadn't. And I said, secondly, here are two living legends, Dampy Bailey and Dave Hughes. And just the friendship they had, the way Dampy was looking after Dave, and the fact Dave insisted on coming to the funeral made them very special people. My first exposure to Dave was before I met him. I used to go to Zimbabwe or Rhodesia, and then there was a gentleman called Dave Simlett. Dave and the two Daves were bosom buddies. And I thought, you know, the Zimbos or Rhodesians, they drink beer, they're pretty good at cricket and rugby, and they probably drink Stein, you know. Anyway, Simlett, the first time I met Dave, he said, you must come to my business, Phillips Central Cellars in the middle of Harare. In the basement was a cellar full of first growths, the best range of wines you could ever find. And obviously, I guess that's where Dave Hughes first got his passion. There's a story that Fiona MacDonald talked about when they tried to make Simlett, I suppose, with the lead partner, their first wine in Zimbabwe, and the first vintage wasn't too successful because they found they put it in a tank that had been storing some other chemicals. But Dave Simlett talked so well of Dave Hughes that I was looking forward to meeting Dave. And Dave left, obviously, then a small pond where he was a big fish, and came to a very big pond where he was a small fish, to come to SFW. My first meeting with Dave was with the legendary Ronnie Malk. So Ronnie invited me to lunch. Now, with Ronnie, if you weren't feeling well, lunch finished at about 5:30. I wasn't feeling too bad, so I went into the evening. But you could see the two of them. Obviously, they both had amazing palates, amazing wine knowledge. And to think SFW, and there are a number of people here, Sue, Jacques, Rue, Benny, was a legendary wine company. And, you know, it's a pity, and I'm not saying it at the expense of Distell, that iconic wine company ever got merged with a major spirit business, because, you know, Dampy and Dave built a proper business there. I mean, in 1964, Lieberstein became the biggest bottled wine in the world. Ronnie Malk used to say he'd go to France, where the French said they had never in cognac ever met a man who could taste cognac like him. But he said, you know, he'd have the best meals in the world, drink the best French wines, but he wanted to come home, sit down and have a bottle of Chateau Nivitas. If you think of Dave, you know, and I don't want to prolong it, but, you know, what an all-rounder. A passionate wine man, a journalist, a wine critic. Think of all the milestones he created in the industry. Simply amazing. I'd like to just maybe close by talking to the younger people in the wine industry. And you might ask the question, is history and the legends in the industry important? And I will say to you, yes, extremely important. Because we're all blessed to be in this business because of the amazing people that have gone before us. Young people in the wine industry are standing on the shoulders of giants. And just to mention a few, Dave Hughes is a giant. Dampy Bailey, Ronnie Malk, Gunter Brusel, Spatz Spurley, Franz Malang, Neil Joubert, Sidney Beck, and I could go on and on and on. So I think it's so important that we remember the history of our industry and the people that have built it for us. And I'd like you going forward in the industry, whether you're a winemaker, a viticulturalist, I'd like you to remember Dave Hughes as you plot your path going forward. What are the key things that Dave has taught us and hopefully going to teach you? He was passionate about our industry. I mean, if you travel the world like I do, what can we as South Africans be proud of? You know, Omar Rusk's chutney does not travel the world. the Springboks win games. I mean, I happened to be in Japan last year, and that was the toughest day of my life. To be with all these Poms and not gloat and high-five and very nice game. One was proud to be a South African. But the one consumer goods product we have as South Africans that we can find in 100 countries around the world is wine. And you young guys have, yes, our wine's getting better. Yes, our focus on viticulture is getting better. But we've got a long way to go. And I want to, before I pass on, I don't want to hear in the UK anymore, nothing like good South African value for money. Shenan at $6.99. I want to see our wines at $200 in the US, £150. The quality's there. So I think Dave leaves you young guys and girls a legacy. He was extremely knowledgeable. He was unbelievably passionate. Yet he was humble. He deserved to be arrogant, but he never was. And he was never too arrogant to share his knowledge. He loved to help one. He was a team player. And the most important thing, he was humble and passionate about our industry. So in closing, can we lift a glass and say, God bless Dave Hughes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tim, for those very wise words. And let's say cheers. Thank you very much. Cheers. Friends, the mic is now available if anybody would like to add a few moments. Francis, are you coming with one glass or two glasses? There's one around your neck. Francis Norton, by the way, the best Afrikaans-speaking Irishman I know.
Ladies and gentlemen, this wasn't actually scheduled. I prepared nothing. I've just been hearing wonderful things about David Hughes. I also heard that Tim and those nice people said they never heard him saying anything bad about anyone. Let me tell you, he said an awful lot of bad things about me. Anyway, he was, when I joined SFW as the token Irishman in 1975, I was a brand manager. I met David, he came into my office. I came in with a beard looking at me. I said, Christ, who's this bushman? He says, Norton, I hear you're Irish. I thought, Christ, I'm going to be thrown out of the country. He says, I'm also Irish. Now that hasn't come out in this presentation, because David's parents were Irish. You might not know that. So in his DNA, he's a Zimbo, a Rhodesian, he's obviously South African, he's an international Kume, but he was very proud of his Irish links. And I have to, this is a bit of a rude story, I'm afraid, so. I was told I shouldn't tell it, but there's a wonderful audience here. I've had three glasses of wine. I stammer very badly. But when I have three glasses of wine, then it goes away. It's unbelievable. So what happened? I was on the brand side, on the spirit side. And I was on the new product development side. And my friends were Ronnie Mugg and obviously Debbie Bailey. But I launched three ships with Ronnie in 79 on spirits. And Ronnie was a good mate. And I said, Ronnie, I want to have a go at a wine. I wasn't on the wine side. Christine Rudd, but you have hundreds of experts of wines. So I thought, I want to have a little go at something. So he said, OK, Norton, but you mustn't cost me any money. So I had to get a hold of a free mold and so on. And we launched a brand called Grasser in 1983. So I thought, Grasser, Irish, what does he know about wine? Anyway, we launched wine. And I went with David, because I was known to be a bit of a, what's the word? A loose cannon, I think was the word. I was a cavalier, or I was full of shit. And David was the more serious one. He was a heavy Christian. I was a very light Christian. Anyway, we went up to Durban, and I had to present. And when I present, I stammer a second time. So you have to wait for a few, after I have three glasses of wine, and then I get into a flow. And David was there doing the wine tasting. And that night, we were staying at the Ilangeni. Now, this is where it gets rude. through the Evangelii, and I was on a high with a very good reaction from people up in New Germany. Is that what it says, New Germany? So anyway, they reacted very well to the spotty wine. I said, David, I'm going downstairs to have a bloody massage. We're going to have out to dinner, we've got some journalists, we're going to have a good evening, we're going to give it a good go. So I had a good massage, deep tissue massage. So I said to this woman after a massage, I was 32. Well, maybe 31, I can't remember, I can't count. Anyway, I said to this person, I've got a friend upstairs, I want him to come down, and I want you to give him the full treatment on me and charge it to room 312. She said, sure. So, well, just in that, I said, David, he's long hair, he's funny socks and so on. Did David go down? I said, no, I don't have massages. David, this is wonderful. He said, it's fantastic for you. I didn't know what a full treatment was for her. I mean, I'm a lapsed Catholic. We don't have these orders. Anyway, so David went down. And then I went down to pick up David. And there he was, Jesus, in an hour later. I said to the girl, where is Mr. Hughes, my guest? He said, he's in that cubicle number 3. I went in to take David. And there's a term we use in Ireland, he was looking totally shagged. So he was looking there, he's a very hairy, you tell me, very hairy man, hairy his chest and his back, and he had his town ovaries over his midwife. And he looked at me, and he looked at me, he says, Norton, he says, you will never go to heaven. What has happened? Now, I know I won't go to heaven, because I'll be down there with Ronnie and with Timothy Bailey having mulled wine, right? But if anyone is in heaven, it's actually David Hughes, because he's a man of high moral fibre. But I take privilege in saying I'm the only man that gave him a happy ending.
I'm so glad that we only had one Irishman in SFW. Can you imagine what would have happened to that company if we had two of them? Friends, anybody else that would like to add? Some of the youngsters would like to say something. No? A study board.
Yeah, for the people that don't know, my name is Lourensford Estate, and I used to work at Stellenbosch Farmers Winery with the Irishman over there, so it's lots of fun. So we spoke a lot about wine this evening, but as you said, Rico, I'm from the Scotch fraternity, so I used to run Bells for 6-7 years at Stellenbosch Farmers Winery. And David was also a keeper of the Quake, so I don't know if you guys are aware of that. And we had very, very fond memories of David at our dinners, we had annual dinners at the castle. For the keepers of the Quake, and then he always used to do the grace for us with his Irish poems, which was hilarious. Most of us were actually looking forward to the evening, to just to hear his grace. It was just fantastic. What a legendary man, and I'm part of the family, so I just thought it appropriate for me just to say a few words on behalf of the Scotch whisky industry as well, from the keepers of the Quake. Craig Doray is the chairman, current chairman of the keepers of the Quake in South Africa. And on behalf of the keepers of the Quake of SA, we would like to also propose a toast to Dave and for everything that he's done in the spirits industry as well, not just only in the wine industry. This man was truly a very universal person when it came to the liquor industry. So, sorry, I haven't got a dram yet, but slangeva to all of you, slangeva.
Thank you very much for adding that to this special day for us, Jeremy.
Hey guys, I'd just like to have a few words as well on behalf of the Wine Swines, which was another organization that Dave founded, co-founded, I think, with a few other people that are in the room here, and Ronnie Milk was probably one of them as well, and Dane P was a very, very important part of the Swines. I was fortunate enough to be invited by Dave to join the Swines. I think it must have been in the sort of mid-late 80s, and it's a wonderful organization. I've been a member of quite a few organizations in the wine industry, and I've always said the most important, the most fun organization of all has been Wine Swines. Dave had showed incredible character right towards the end. Even in December, only a few months ago, and we had a wine swines meeting in Fishhook at Dave Biggs's home. Any of you who know where Dave Biggs lived, it's up quite a few a big flight of stairs. And a few months before that, also Quibus Joubert's home in St. James, which I think has got 102 or 110 stairs getting up to his house. And Dave had the guts to be with us and to say he's still part of the team, no matter what his condition is health-wise. And he was there. He was a sport right to the end. And I really am grateful for him inviting me to join Swines and all the great times and tastings I've had there. And just other wonderful times with Dave over the years. One of the classic stories of Dave, which I think he actually reported in the back of Wine Magazine, he was entertaining a wine fundi journalist, I won't mention the guy's name, but somebody who hated Pinotage. Name wasn't André van Rensburg. But anyway, this guy was very anti-Pinotage, and Dave was entertaining him one evening, and they went out for dinner, and Dave, prior to going out, had actually decanted a bottle of Pinotage into a Cabernet bottle. And they went out for dinner with this journalist, and they had this evening together, and Dave said, what do you think of the wine? And the guy was very, you know, he really liked the wine, and he gave it a great report, and at the end of the day, Dave said to him, well, I'd like to let you know you've just enjoyed your first bottle of Pinotage. The guy was apparently very pissed off with Dave, but that was part of Dave's personality. So I mean, all of the swines, I mean, there's a couple of us that are here, a lot of the guys couldn't make it, but all the swines really loved Dave, and we were, you know, swines won't be quite the same without him, and with Dave P, and with some of the others that have gone before them, but whenever we get together, we'll be thinking of those guys.
Thank you very much.
And all male wine societies,
Christine?
I was asked to say a few words on behalf of the Cape Wine Academy and the Institute of Cape Wine Masters, because neither of the heads of those two could actually be here. So one of Dave's legacies in South Africa is wine education. And those very early days at SFW, he had this idea, which he sold to the company for financing, that if you teach people about wine, it increases sales, and it also makes them drink more widely, more, you know, but much more adventure. So they bought into it. He established the Cape Wine Academy. He had the right kind of structure and everything. He made Phyllis Hands the head of that because he respected her good wine writer, good wine knowledge. And in fact, they ended up writing books together. And there were various courses developed over the years, and I got involved in the Cape Wine Academy at one stage of my career. Lots of different courses throughout the country, and you might like to know that to date, 220,000 students have gone through the Cape Wine Academy. So that's actually astonishing. And then leading on from there, Cape Wine Masters. So eventually Dave thought, you know, it can't just end at a diploma. So maybe it has to go further, like a much more advanced kind of course. And as you've heard, he had contacts around the world, very highly respected, which included the British Masters of Wine. So he spoke to them about an equivalent sort of course in South Africa. Obviously, you know, geared to the South African market, but that sort of standard. And they bought into it. So he set up an organization that would do this thing, and they even marked the first exam papers and thought that the standard, and that's not common knowledge, they thought the standard was actually pretty bloody high. So this is Hughes, not just at the bottom end of the wine education market, but the top end of the wine education market. Giving value, giving quality to the wine industry. And in the 42 years that they've been Cape Wine Masters, there are now 109 throughout the world. So a lot of them living in South Africa in the different provinces, also living in America, in the UK, in Europe, and Australia. So another drink to Dave Hughes and his vision.
Hi, Dougie Christine. Friends, two more announcements if nobody else wants to run to the front. There's a book to sign with all Dave's photographs and memorabilia. If you can also be so good as to go to the brandy table and have a brandy with Dave and with Christelle at the back. And then the food, there's some hot food coming out as well. Please enjoy yourselves, and a great thank you to everybody who has donated wine for this occasion, and also for those institutions in the industry that contributed to presenting the function and the food. And finally, to Koos Jordaan of Lourensford, who's been absolutely marvelous for giving us this venue free of charge. Hi, Ducky. Koos, thank you very much for everybody coming. Please enjoy the rest of the afternoon and let us celebrate the life of Dave Hughes. Thank you.